Hey folks, welcome to the Physics Labs. This week, we're going to be taking a look at some experiments using quantum mechanics, which is pretty darn neat. Now, the thing you really want to care about this week is that all this quantum mechanics stuff is about transitions between different energy levels. Now, we've got some great equations at the beginning of the lab that show you know the equation for what's the energy of the ground state, n equals 1, the first excited state, n equals 2, n equals 3, 4, etc., etc. And those are all well and good, but what really matters is that when an electron jumps between those energy levels, it's going to give you a photon, and it's the energy difference between those two states that matters. That's the energy of the photon that will be spitting out. Now, in order to measure the energy of these photons, we're going to use a whole bunch of different equipment. The main important one is going to be the spectrometer that we've got. The way this thing works is it lets light in through this hole on the front right here. That light gets broken up into all the different wavelengths, and then it measures the intensity of each one of those wavelengths, and then displays it out on a graph. So let me show you a bit about how this works. On the screen here, I've got opened up the spectrometer software, and what you'll want to do is click this box in the upper left corner, because that opens up all of the settings for the spectrometer. Now there's a couple things we want to change. First off is the sample time. Right now it's set as a default to 10 samples to average, which means it'll read through once, and then twice, three times, four times, 10 times, and display that latest update. We want to go ahead and make this a little bit quicker, so we can change that to 1. The other thing you'll want to mess around with is the sample time. Right now it's set to 32 milliseconds, and what that means is that it's only letting in a little bit of light. We're going to change that a lot at a bunch of our different stations, because we want to make sure that we can see the shape of the graph itself. We don't really care how intense the light is, how bright the light is. What matters this week is the shape of the spectrum itself. Now, one of the first big experiments that we're going to use in order to take a look at a spectrum are these quantum dots, which what I've got here are a whole bunch of little tiny molecules, and if I hit it with an ultraviolet light, the molecules fluoresce and give off a color. What we're doing is exciting those electrons with the UV light, and then because those electrons are stuck on that molecule, we're going to treat this as a one-dimensional box. And if we were to take a look at those colors themselves, right now, for example, I'm getting a very small peak on the graph. If I were to increase the sample time up to 320 milliseconds, oh, that peak got a lot bigger. That is beautiful. I'm going to go ahead and freeze that on the screen. Cool. What we're going to do is take a look at the spectrum right here and try to figure out what is that peak wavelength, because that's going to give us the average energy that these photons are coming off the molecule with. If I know that energy, again, that energy is the transition between the first excited state, n equals 2, and the ground state, n equals 1. If we can figure out what that difference is, we should be able to calculate how big these molecules actually are. Now, we're going to take a look at the quantum dot. That's one of the really important ones. The other really important one I want to show you first is the photoelectric effect. What we've got here is a metal dish with an electrode in the middle of it. And what we're going to do is shine light onto the outer edge there, the cathode. That's going to eject electrons, and if they make it all the way to the anode, we can actually measure a current there. So what you want to do is we will turn this thing on and crank the voltage adjust all the way up, block all the light, and then go ahead and set the zero adjust so that absolutely no current is making it through. Then what we'll do is shine a laser in here, and the laser, when it strikes that cathode, is again freeing electrons, and as those electrons try to make it to the anode, we are going to adjust how much voltage we apply in order to create an electric field and try to stop those electrons. And we'll change that voltage around, try to figure out exactly when does that current go to zero. Now, if you don't apply any voltage, we're going to get a lot of current. If you apply a ton of voltage to there, then no current is going to flow at all. But what we want to do is try to find that minimum amount of current to completely stop those electrons in their tracks. If we know how much voltage it takes in order to stop those electrons, we know the size of that potential hill the electrons are trying to roll over. And so we can figure out how much extra energy the electrons had left over. If we know how much energy they had left over, we know how much energy we're giving them from our laser, we can figure out what the work function is for that material, which is a pretty darn neat thing. Now let me go ahead and clear the decks. I'll show you some other experiments. We'll have some fun. All right, now two other stations that we're going to look at will involve using the spectrometer to see how does the shape of the spectrum change. First station is going to be looking at the spectrum of an LED, and what we want to note is, as we change the voltage applied to the LED, how does that affect the spectrum? Now again, we care about the shape of the spectrum, not the intensity, so you can either move the LEDs further back or closer, or change the sample time in Logger Pro there. The other thing we're going to take a look at is black body radiation. If I were to heat up a wire, the hotter and hotter it gets, the more visible light it's going to give off. And of course, as it changes temperature, it's actually going to be changing how much of the different wavelengths of light it gives off. And our goal for you is to figure out how does the spectrum change as we change the temperature of this wire. Now what you're going to need to do is vary the voltage, and we're going to go from a bright orange on here down to maybe a nice deep reddish color, and look at how does the spectrum change? How does the peak wavelength of the spectrum itself change? Now, big safety concern here is that this is a very, very hot wire. Don't touch it, don't lick it, don't let anything else touch it either, because we really don't want you or the equipment to get hurt. And of course, make sure we turn everything down and off when you're nice and done. Let's take a look at a few more. Now, if you want to get nice and quantitative, we've got some stations for you too. We've got the hydrogen spectrum here, and what we'll ask you to do is calculate what wavelengths of light is hydrogen going to emit really well when we run some electricity through it. You go ahead and calculate that stuff out, take a look with the rainbow glasses, and see exactly what we hope to show up. Now, if you want to get qualitative, we can also take a look at figuring out exactly how glow-in-the-dark materials actually work. What we've got for you is a glow-in-the-dark sheet, a whole bunch of different LEDs which give off different colors of light. We'll shine them on the paper, see which ones leave trails and don't, and see some pretty darn cool physics. Now, there's one LED you might think is broken. It's this one. It's actually an infrared LED. Now, the other thing we can take a look at too is Brownian motion. I'm going to go ahead and leave the experiment to you in the labs, but let me give you a little bit of the theory here. If you take a look at the laser dot when it's hitting this white surface, and either take off your glasses, hold a magnifying glass in front of your eyes, or basically lose focus, what you will see is not just the bright dot itself, but rather the speckle pattern. Now, that speckle pattern we're showing you here is actually what an optical mouse uses when it tries to see how you're moving it around on the desktop. And we're going to use that speckle pattern in an optical mouse in order to actually measure the motion of molecules, which is pretty darn cool. Now, there's going to be a couple other stations out in the lab for you. We, of course, add new things every single year, so definitely keep an eye out for that. But otherwise, have yourselves a great week.